Welcome everyone and thanks for tuning in to the Symposium on the Future of XR in Healthcare. And many thanks for the opportunity to present the work that we've been doing at the interface of virtual reality and cognitive diagnostics and rehabilitation. In particular, I'm going to present Project VReha, whose full title is Virtual Worlds for Digital Diagnostics and Cognitive Rehabilitation that we've been working on over the past years. I hardly have to remind you what virtual reality is. I still want to give a very short introduction. It's what I'm referring to is the combination of 360-degree content that is attached to the head by means of a virtual reality headset. And then the head movement, which is measured, is integrated into the visualization of computer-generated content, which yields immersive VR. The benefits of immersive VR, but also of VR in general, of non-immersive VR for neuropsychology are manifold. I'm just presenting a couple of facets in that virtual reality allows the precise measurements of behavior in the spatial and temporal domain of the users. It allows multidimensional presentation of naturalistic dynamic stimuli. It also allows the full control over the virtual environments. It allows the presentation of adaptive computer-generated content that may exist in parallel versions. It's relatively safe compared to, for example, real-world interventions. And if gamified, it also has a motivating component. The aspects of cognitive rehabilitation that we're working on are based on the observation that cognitive deficits are very prevalent and part of many diseases, both in the neurological but also in the psychiatric domain. And the task, the central tasks, now in a simplified version of neuropsychology, can be described as the reliable and valid assessment and improvement of relevant functions. And by relevant, I mean relevant for the daily life of the patients. The idea is to assess these functions, but also to not only assess these functions, but also improve them with the goal of a social and professional reintegration of these patients. A particular cognitive component or psychological component that is often impaired is spatial memory, which has two important features in that it shows a large inter-individual variance. That is, people differ tremendously on how well they're able to memorize the location of objects in space. And it has been shown to be a marker for the diagnosis, but also early quantification with the aim of predicting, for example, dementia diseases. One reason for that is that spatial memory and where it's processed in the brain shares kind of neural substance that is early on impaired in the progression of, for example, Alzheimer's disease. Then what we did, we took these ingredients, namely the observation that we wanted to make use of virtual reality technology to assess and improve cognitive impairments, in particular spatial memory. And we needed to find a way to do that. And as scientists, we wanted to do that systematically, which is something that we also shared recently with you, for example, or other peers, in that you can use our heuristics, which we created for the multidimensional evaluation, which paradigm to choose for the aim that we intended, namely, for example, the diagnostics and rehabilitation of spatial memory, and kind of use this heuristic to decide which of the reported tasks is the most suitable to be transferred into the immersive VR technology. For that, I don't want to go into all the details, but we have these 10 dimensions, which then allow a kind of semi-quantitative assessment of along these facets, which then helps to evaluate which of the potential paradigms to choose. And when we did that, we identified the so-called virtual memory test or virtual memory task, the VMT, as the most suitable candidate for our purposes. So what's the immersive virtual memory task that we then created? Here it's a simplified introduction. In the first step, participants or users or patients are asked to memorize the arrangement of objects on a table. This arrangement is then changed after the memorization phase, and participants are asked to recall and kind of reconstruct this arrangement as it was before, so that we as evaluators can then calculate the distance error as a measure of performance. So for example, here, this flask in kind of this semi-transparent flask indicates the original position. And then here the flask is the reconstructed position, and we can quantify by, for example, assessing the Euclidean distance between these two locations in space, how well did the participants memorized and recalled the locations of these objects in space. For that, we first needed to create a set of items. And this is what we did. We took and standardized 124 household objects, which we had. Ah, yes, I will show a couple of examples. Household objects that are common from normal daily life. Here are just a selected few of them. For example, a rubber ducky from having a bath, or a hairdryer, or a pear, which we then obviously did not create only in 2D, but in 3D. So for example, here or here, there are examples. And these we also recently made available for free under this link, so under this reference. It's work by Johanne Tromp. And what we not only created these, but we also had them evaluate, for which we invited around 30 younger and 30 older participants. And we showed these objects to them and asked them how recognizable they are, they thought they were, how familiar they were to them, how much their estimated level of detail was, how often they're in contact with them, and how often they use them, and so on. And then we also released these norms or metrics with them, together with the objects, so that for any given purpose, also beyond the immersive virtual memory task, they can be used in research or clinical applications. So now coming back to the creation and validation or early validation of our MVMT task. The technical details were that we opted for the Oculus Rift VR headset together with the Leap Motion hand tracking sensor, because we wanted to allow a naturalistic interaction with the virtual environments in order to facilitate the use of the MVMT for older participants or neurological patients. We also optimized the whole development of the MVMT for such participant groups, in that we made it possible to interact with these environments or fulfill the task or complete the task, also having motor or visual impairments, but then also, as I said, to allow an easy handling that does not require knowledge of controllers, for example, by means of gesture-based interactions. We also tested this in a couple of neurological patients, and we found no or very minimal traces of cyber sickness and a high degree of immersion, as reported by Julia Belger in last year's ICVR conference. So to make it more graspable, these are a couple of videos that I brought from our setup and our task. So this is, as I said, the environment, the hardware that was used. Here you can see an example of the hand tracking and a user who is currently placing, in this recall phase, placing the objects back on the table. As I said, the VR, particularly immersive VR, allows the quantification of the behavior of the users with a high resolution in time and space, which then enables us as experimenters or clinicians to analyze the behavior and performance with high precision. So here just a rendering, a sketch again of a user, and we have complete knowledge about the trajectories of the hands and the movements of the head, for example, in addition to these measures that I presented before, like the mean distance error or the task completion time. We also, in creating our application or our toolbox, the VRIHA toolbox, not only thought about the patients or the participants or users, but we also thought about the clinical personnel. And we created a web-based interface that allows a rather easy and certainly secure saving of the user characteristics, also clinical user characteristics. As an early feasibility and early evaluation, we took our MVMT and we presented it to, we had 30 younger and 30 older healthy controls complete the task. But for that, I briefly want to also show how the task as a whole looks like. So as I presented before, there's the recall phase in which you have 15 seconds to memorize the arrangement of the items on the table. Then the items are shuffled or placed on side tables and you're asked to rearrange them so that we can then evaluate your performance, which by the way is not shown to the participants. In our study, we parametrically manipulated three factors. One was the number of items on the table, which could be 3, 5, or 7 objects. The placement, as I mentioned already, that in after the memorization phase, the items were either reshuffled on the table or they were placed, also shuffled, but placed on side tables. And then to make things harder, we also manipulated the rotation angle after the memorization phase, which is also indicated, for example, by this bar. So in the memorization phase, you always were at, so to say, 0 degree. But then before the recall phase, you were rotated around the table and inside the room, either by 90 degree, 180 degree, or 270 degrees. So after the introduction, there was first block one without rotation, then there was a pause, and then there was block two with rotation with 18 trials. So the data, I will show you the data from our evaluation study in healthy controls with 28 younger and 26 older healthy adults. And we found, I just show you the selected graph. So here on the x-axis, you see the number of objects, either 3, 5, or 7. And you see the mean distance error, so our main outcome measure, how precise or how badly people reconstructed the arrangement, the original arrangement. In blue, you see the younger, and in red, you see the older adults' performance. And here you see that there's differences between the groups and also with an increase in number of objects, you see an increase in the error rate. So the lower the values, the better the task performance. The higher the values, the more error there is. And this was also corroborated or shown in the statistics in that there was a slight non-significant trend in the difference between the groups. The younger ones, the younger participants performing better or showing less errors. There was a strongly significant influence of the number of objects on the mean distance error. There was a strongly significant influence of the rotation angle on the mean distance error, but there was also an interaction between the number of objects and rotation angle, and all other factors, like for example, the placement, either the side tables or the reshuffle, was not significant. So as a summary and as an outlook, we showed that our MVMT, by manipulating the parameters or by introducing parameters and manipulating them, we could create inter-individual variance, which was important because this variance can then be of clinical relevance. And to find out to what degree this is clinically relevant, we're currently testing several clinical samples. Actually, most of them are on hold currently due to COVID-19, unfortunately, but we've already assembled and measured quite large amounts of patients. For example, patients with acquired brain damage at the day clinic, at the project partner of the day clinic for cognitive neurology in Leipzig, but also in patients with Alzheimer's disease or multiple sclerosis in Berlin at the Charité. We show that the MVMT and our approach to using immersive virtual reality in healthcare is largely automatized and is very feasible. And we're currently, to make it even more feasible and easy to handle, we currently port our task and the toolbox to untethered VR, to an untethered VR headset. We're also currently analyzing additional measures beyond the error performance, such as, for example, the time it took to complete the task, but also then the hand and the head movements, as I presented before, because our aim is to not only quantify the performance, but also be able to infer underlying processes, which then promises to allow individualized training procedures, for example, with similar setups. So overall, we proposed the IMVMT, so the Immersive Virtual Memory Task, and in general, the VRIHA toolbox for the diagnosis, monitoring, and personalized rehabilitation of cognitive deficits as an example of using XR and in particular immersive VR in healthcare. As an additional outlook, I also want to present branches of this project, one being that we combine immersive VR headsets with physiological measures, either by attaching electrodes to the heads of people to measure the brain waves, but then also attaching electrodes to the chest, where we recently created the open source Unity plugin, the so-called excitometer, which allows the integration of physiological signals, particularly of cardiac activity, into Unity and into the development and evaluation of XR content. This was kindly funded by the European Commission in the XR for All funding scheme. But also within VRIHA, we are currently developing another immersive VR application in the shape of a supermarket to approximate activities of daily life even more, which then allows the testing of additional cognitive capacities beyond spatial memory for the diagnostics and rehabilitation of cognitive disorders. And with that, I would like to thank the whole team, because what I presented obviously is a large team effort. Here's one of the photographs that shows at least a couple of the people. The project partners are beyond my institute, the Max Planck Institute for Human Cognitive and Brain Sciences, Leipzig, at the University of Leipzig, in particular the Day Clinic for Cognitive Neurology, but then also the Fraunhofer Heinrich Hertz Institute in Berlin, the Charité Universitätsmedizin Berlin, and the Hasomed GmbH. And this was kindly funded by the German Ministry of Research and Education. And if you want to know more about VRIHA and the VRIHA project, feel free to visit VRIHA-project.com. Thank you very much for your attention.